Early on the first morning, Dakwaza prays and offers beer, calling on God, Jigle, and on his ancestors for aid. A stone lintel set across the top of the shaft opening provides a strong base for the charge hole and the shield to be built above. On the third day, the facade and furnace shaft are given coats of daub, and the bellows platform reaches its full height. The furnace is magically strengthened by the addition of a decorated daub belt. With scarcely a pause, Dakwaza and his sons go on to assemble the bellows, binding and plastering them firmly into place on the stone support. At home that afternoon, Dakwaza and Badadak begin to build the tuyir, a long tube that directs the air blast from the bellows down into the belly of the furnace. The furnace is now complete, but must again be left to dry for 2 days while Dakwaza rests and does other jobs. All is now ready for the smelt. At 7:10 a.m., without ceremony, Dakwaza and Badadak insert the tuyir. To prevent the shaft seal from collapsing under its own weight, he supports it with split twigs of fire-resistant ebony. Then, before all those who have worked on the furnace, and those other smiths, Dakwaza's relatives, who are to participate in today's efforts, Dakwaza prays, offers beer, and consecrates the Jigle pot that will be set to guard the smelt. Now is the time for war. It is 3 minutes past 10. After working the bellows for a moment, and they will never cease until the smelt is over 10 hours and 21 minutes later, Dakwaza hands over to his son Hishekit, descends to the lower platform and checks that the charge is well and truly lit. Satisfied that it is, he will now retire to his compound to prepare for battle. Dakwaza plays the bellows like drums. Batai strikes up his harp and they sing antiphonally. This is the first time that music has been allowed near the furnace. Pasty slag now flows to block the vent and is cut out. Dusk at 6:15. The vent is now much higher. The smelt continues at full blast. But by 7:30, DeQuaz's stock of ore is running low and he is tiring. He has blown the bellows longer and harder than any, and has also prized out the slag. In the old days, with more and more experienced bellowsmen, the smelt would have continued until the bloom mass had filled the shaft. Night falls. Charging of ore and charcoal ceases. Baldagai, another son, removes the pile of rocks and ash and cuts through the sides of the shaft seal. At 8:24, the bellows fall silent. The seal is cut away, revealing the stump of the 2-year and a bloom over 40 centimeters high and weighing 15.5 kilos. The long day's work is over, and the bloom carried hurriedly away to DeQuaz's compound. Before DeQuaz can forge a hoe from the bloomery iron, he must first refine it. After praying for success, he begins this process mechanically by breaking up a part of the bloom mass and picking out the metallic droplets and lumps. DeQuaz fills 4 of the crucibles with bits of iron. He dribbles a clay slurry over the iron to protect it from reoxidation. He places the first crucible in the fire. He pulls the semi-molten mass from the fire. After reheating the iron, DeQuaz directs as Baldagai draws out the iron into a short bar using a massive smooth stone hammer. The hoe is now almost complete. The socket is first flattened with the smooth hammer and then spread with the ridged one. The smith forms the socket. Baldagai gives the hoe, the tool on which Mafa agriculture and indeed Mafa life depends, its final touches.